Now, we're going to talk about some of this today on the show, just because Larry's professional life and my personal life intersected through a lot of the magazines and places that we're going to talk about. Because back in the early 90s, at least for me, I had been on the internet since 1984. So I was this kid in this little Appalachian town that grew up on these message boards, and like I had dialed into the well for a little while. It was exploring all of this stuff, and I didn't understand what a lot of it was because I was 12, 13, 14 years old. But I was fascinated by the conversations and the exploration of technology and community that was happening in these virtual spaces, long before the web, right? There's not that many 12-year-olds in Appalachia that was using Telnet to dial into these places. And I was absolutely fascinated. And along the way, as I got older, I came across publications like the original Boing Boing, which was a magazine before it was a website, Mondo 2000, a whole bunch. I think The Future of Sex was one, which sort of grew out of the sort of techno interpersonal relations stuff. And eventually in the 90s, we have things like Might Magazine and a bunch of stuff like Alternet, the Utne Reader, all of these things that sort of grew out of the alt-weekly GenX zine sensibility. I read the stuff incessantly, couldn't put it down. And I'll be honest, I didn't understand what a lot of it meant because it was very specific to particularly California culture and particularly like Bay Area culture, at least in terms of like Boing Boing and Mondo and Might. Had some New York, had some Bay Area. And so I just didn't know. But it was a thing that I was like a moth to a flame. I knew that that was my tribe. Those were my people. And so that was what I always knew. I was going to go to Berkeley for graduate school. Didn't know how I was going to make that happen. Didn't know why I felt that way. I just thought, well, I need to be out there. So when I get there years later, and, you know, Larry had been part of lots of these things, you know, Mother Jones, Ms. Magazine, I was reading all of that stuff. Larry was working in that. And so he was, you know, a few years ahead of me doing these kinds of things. So our paths were intersecting before we even knew each other, before I got out to California and started my career. Over the years, you know, when you're a writer in a magazine world doing these kinds of weird-ass things that, you know, other people are sort of looking at you side-eye in, the community is not that big, which is why we have so many people in common, just because, like, you sort of moved around in that sphere. Until the tech boom hit, all that stuff was like weird subculture stuff. I ended up at Wired just at the time that everything blew up. So really, like, I was the guy that showed up after the neighborhood stopped being cool. But it was still part of that world. And like, I still trace myself back to Mondo and all of that kind of stuff. Like, that is my sensibility. When I moved to Austin, and we talk about Katie Ford, who is friends with Piper and was my first editor in Austin, I was writing for a place called Fringeware, which was an alien, you know, shop that had a magazine and bookstore. And by alien, I mean like space alien. Like, those were my people. Like, Paco Nathan was, that was sort of where I was running around in. And for those of you who are listening, some of this stuff probably doesn't even make sense to you, which is the point. That whole network of people who went on to become well-known people, established writers. I mean, Larry met Dave Eggers the first time he wrote a column for the East Bay Express, which is how he ended up working at Might Magazine. All of these things were like the proving grounds and the staging grounds for the next 20 years of magazine storytelling and long-form storytelling and lots of the discussions about the weird subcultures around technology. Not the gadget stuff, but the actual culture around it is where that was happening. And if you're ever online, Heather Gold and I will occasionally have these discussions about that sort of early web time, because there really is two webs. There really is two technologies. There's this weird bro-y Silicon Alley thing and Silicon Valley thing, this sort of New York and California make a new gadget. But in the beginning, it was this community of weirdos who found each other and who were looking at the world in a different place. And part of my failings as a Wired writer was that that was the aesthetic that I came out of. And so I never really truly saw the bro culture happening because that was not the lens into which I came into any of this. And I think Larry's very much the same way. You're going to hear this conversation. And the reason, I mean, he worked at Alternet. He worked at these places that were very specifically looking for other ways to tell stories. And starting a magazine that's built around user-generated content wasn't unique, but the idea of what he wanted to do with it was very egalitarian. And it's why it's taken off, because it really is the best ethos of that time and place. And I sound like a fucking old man because I'm an old man. But all I can tell you is that time, that Mondo, Boing Boing, Miz, and Miz had been around before that, Mother Jones, Utne Reader, Alternet, Future of Sex, all of those things, and the web communities that were developing around them, or the, I guess the internet communities before the web, were so freeing. Because it was the first time you could find weirdo people like yourself and connect with them without worrying about the location. And so when I rolled into Berkeley, and I've told the story, I didn't know anybody, really. I mean, I knew David Peskovitz and I knew a couple other folks, but I knew the community of people that were there, and I knew where they were, and I knew how to find them. You know, for a poor kid from Appalachia, that felt pretty good. Going 3,000 miles from home. So that was what was going through my mind when Larry reached out to me and said, hey, man, I want to be on the program. And I thought, yeah, because you were at that time and place with me, with all this other group of people. And it's really hard to explain it. And as you listen to this interview, what I really hope you get out of this is a sense of wonderment about what that was. Not the bro stuff, not the Silicon Valley and Silicon Alley stuff, but the essence of what that world really was then. So that's what you got coming. That's what we're going to talk about today. It's all filtered through Larry, who's fucking fascinating and amazing and wonderful. And there's a couple really funny moments. There's many funny moments, but there's a couple of those like, oh shit, I had no idea that, you know, you were part of this famous couple. Because why would I? And it's one of the beautiful things about life.